Hey, Jonas. Wait, can you hear me? Pepe! Come here, Pepe.
Like, sometimes I'm home, and my father in many ways is the smartest person I've ever met. Minneapolis!
Can you hear me? If so, we're going to be picking out colors and putting in trees and putting down stuff, and then we're going to... I don't know what we're going to do. I have to get the dog situated. Come here. Puppet. All right. Not a life work, but, somewhat of a life work. Normal brown, or should it be orange? Windows. Or just like a layer of orange windows. Guess that's what we're trying to figure out. I have no idea where Gage is right now. I left him somewhere and I swam here, which is kind of funny, instead of fast traveling. Because if I would have fast traveled, he would have, you know, popped in. Thank you. Great use of the word Fibonacci. We've already had one ape casualty because Myalurks spawn randomly over here, which is weird. So to stop that from happening again, we'll do that. Some gorillas were inside for some odd reason.
work. Coming out in the weather. In the holidays. Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. If you are an atheist, I hope you got your laundry done. I love that joke. I tell it every year. Every year. Every year with that joke. Never gets old. I'm like somebody's dad with that fucking joke. I have my notes up here because I'm taping a new album, you guys. Very glamorous. I always tape here at Acme because Acme is the best. And it's a wonderful place. You've chosen wisely. If you've never been, this is the greatest. If you don't like me, come back next week. Turns out there's another coming. But I will say this is... I had the best setup. I had, the greatest lineup of jokes. 45 minutes of gold. And then the world went to shit 6 weeks ago. So then, mine is paralyzed. Here's the thing. Because I don't do political material. But I do now, I guess, because I'm human. Because I'm alive in America. And I like things like the Declaration and the Constitution. We seem like there's a goddamn mess in front of us. Anyway, did anybody else call that we were going to be the bad guys in World War III? Did you know that? I did not know that. I did not call that. You know, I've tried that line a couple of times, and about 6 months ago, July 2016, I tried that line up in Canada to dead silence. We all laughed. Dead silence up in Canada. Chirp. Chirp, guy in the fourth row goes, "We knew." And I was like, "What?" He said, "How long have you known?" He goes, "Decades, we've known for decades, we've seen it coming." Oh, God, I don't know, it's, because I'm from Wisconsin, which is on fire right now, and I love it, it's like the Shire for me, but here's the thing about it. When I was a kid in Wisconsin, I'm from a little factory town outside of Milwaukee, a little factory town called South Milwaukee. It's a long story. It's not my fault. Let's not get into it. It's a factory town. It's its own town. Now, when I was a child, there were six Catholic churches, six very beautiful Catholic churches. Now there are two Catholic churches, and there are four buildings that have been deconsecrated, and about 6 months ago, one of those buildings got turned into a mosque. And a school. And so I called my dad. And my father, 79 years old, and by no stretch of the imagination is my father a liberal. By no stretch of the imagination. Or, by the way, a conservative. My father, very much a pragmatist. What my father said during the election was, "She's not hot, but she's overqualified." So making friends, my dad, every time he opens his face. And so I call him up and I was like, "How's everybody in South Milwaukee handling the new mosque, Dad? How are they taking it?" And he goes, "Most people are fine. Most people get it. Some people are idiots, of course. But some, most people, they know that it just means 30 years from now, a place is going to be crawling with lapsed Muslims. Who gives a shit?" He is, of course, correct. And I have talked to people from high school and I've tried to explain to them on Facebook because that's where people want to be explained to. No, they don't. That we are talking about Wisconsin Muslims. Minnesotans, you get it. It's a Wisconsin Muslim. First of all, there are nine. Second of all...
Hi, Charlie.
You're going to go to a picnic and there's going to be a weird jello salad. That's going to be the whole story. That's it. You're going to have to say to some woman in a hat, hey, is there mint in this? Yes, there is. And you're going to share a bass boat with a guy named Salim instead of Doug. It's America. Get used to it. We're all immigrants. I don't care if you're Native Americans. 11,000 years ago, you came over the Siberian Strait, and nobody came on purpose. Nobody came because things were going well. I don't know what your ancestors were like, but none of mine were sitting on a pile of Scrooge McDuck money in some Whitey Magoo country thinking to themselves, "You know what? You know what I want to do? Start over." Sometimes I'm home, and my father in many ways is the smartest person I've ever met in my life. 85% of the time, he's the smartest guy in the world. 15% of the time, he is speaking from a little-known country called Banana Land. But aren't we all? Aren't we all? Those aren't bad odds. And
90% of the time his advice is amazing, 15% of the time he has handed you a monkey's paw, and you are making a wish that could curse you for eternity. And but you don't know, you're just going forward. And I was reading a science fiction book, I read a lot, and I was reading a science fiction book not long ago, and he said, what are you reading over there? And I said, well, it's a book about a dystopian future, Dad. And he said, yeah, have you looked around? We live in a dystopian present. Future's just going to be like now. You're going to be driving a 5-year-old car and looking for work. What the hell? And my father is a glass half full kind of guy, is what I'm saying. And when I was 8 years old, the first time my father was proud of me, I'm the youngest of six, I have 4 older brothers and an older sister, and the first time my father was even proud of me, I was 8 years old. I came home from school, and there was no one there but him. I don't know why he was there. I don't know why he decided. My father is a lot like radiation. He affected our lives a lot, but we never saw him. But for some reason, he was there after school. And I'm not saying he didn't have his keys in his hand, but he decided to try some parenting. And he goes, what are you, 8? What is that, 3rd grade? And I said, yes, it is 3rd grade, Dad. And he said, what are you studying in school in 3rd grade? And I said, well, we're studying the end of the Mesopotamian Empire, the Phoenician and the Mesopotamian Empires. And he goes, yeah, empires end. What's that tell you? And I said, that empires end? And he goes, Yeah, but what's that tell you about America? And I said, that one day America's gonna end? And he goes, yeah. Sleep tight. First time he was proud of me, you guys. It's a little dark. So when the election happened, I, of course, terrified. Like many people, scared, thinking about, you know, registration acts and deporting millions of people and everybody's brown or has a limp or some fucking thing. And, train fulls of people, always gathering people by religion and color. It's always worked out well for the world. And so I was terrified. And you know where I got my hope? I got my hope from my black friends, from my brown friends. I got all litany kind of friends, right? I got all the friends that are in line ahead of me. But I got, right? You got your lesbians with kids, and you got your handicapped, and you got your people who have kids that are disabled, and your Asian Muslims, and whoever the fuck. Anyway, so I got lots of those friends, but I got my hope from my black and my brown friends, who I was talking to, because that's what they needed, was to reassure me. And, and I said, hey, I'm scared. And to a person, they said, yeah, it's scary. It's really scary right now. But, you know, we just got screwed again. You just get up and you keep going. That's what you do. You get in the way of crummy behavior if you see it, and you just keep going. You just keep going and make sure you're happy. Nobody wants you to be happy, so make sure every day you try to be happy. And I was like, just get up? And one of my friends said, Jesus, is this the first time you've been disappointed? Got a little defensive. I was like, no, Jesse Ventura. He was a scary, I'm gonna make a boatload of money guy off the government. No, maybe not the same as Nazis and Klansmen. So yes, but here's the real reason I'm mad, is because now I have to get up. I have to get up and get in the way of bad behavior, because 2% of the people on this planet are bad. Everybody else, I genuinely believe this. I believe that everybody's great, but 2% are broken, and 2% are out of their damn minds, and they're going to grab genitals and say horrible things and be mean to people, and now I, who want to be Captain America, have to stand in front of them and be a big white lady meat shield, and, I don't want to be a white lady meat shield. I was hoping just to coast to the twilight of my life and fall over in a heap. That was it. That was going to be it. And now I have to get up. And I don't want to. I want to get a remote, pay someone, get Amazon to fucking do it. I don't know what I want. I'm a Prime member. Does no one care? But now, and I got friends, like I have gay friends and relatives who are like, their kids came home from school and they were scared. Are they going to take us away from you, mommies? And I'm like, first sign of that, fucking run, I said to them. No reason to be brave, get the fuck out. I was not raised to be the hero of anything, but I guess I will be. I was like, I don't have any kids. I can be a white lady meat shield. You can throw me in front of it. I would like a small statue, something tasteful. Possibly slimming. That would be nice. And you have to complain laterally, you guys. I'm sorry to obsess, but I, middle-aged white lady over here, can mostly just complain to white guys. That's it. Those are the only guys who are behind me in line. Everyone in front of me in line, they get to complain to me, and I have to be supportive. That's the rule. That is the rule. And I didn't make the rule. That's the fucking rule. If you are a white guy, you have to get in the way of bad behavior, and you have to clean out your attic so you can hide people. That's your job. That's your fucking job.
You gotta clean out your attic.
I also didn't make that rule. That is traditionally the rule of decent white men throughout the centuries. So my grandmother, see, and the reason, and I mostly care about, like, the registering of religious people, because I am a Christian. Don't applaud. Nobody ever does. it's fine, because everyone who says they're a Christian usually says, I never tell anyone, because the next words out of somebody's mouth is always something horrifying. So I never do tell anyone. I just try to be, because I was raised in a very nice church where it was essentially be like the nice man in the picture and go get your dad some coffee. That was the whole plan. That was the whole religion in a nutshell. It was please pick up the dishes and try to be nice. So, I'm Armenian, which, here's the thing. In Wisconsin, I have to explain that it's not a Baltic swordfish. It's a country in the middle of nowhere. And the Armenian Christians were killed in a genocide in 1915. The Turks deny it. They've taught their children and their grandchildren it never happened. Here's what I have to say. If you're holding a genocide, by the way, don't take pictures. You're not smart. That's not smart. Too many photos. We see what you're doing. Okay, so, but here's the thing. And my grandmother, at 16, picked up a 2x4 and beat the priest off of the donkey. Yeah. And she told me that story when I told her that I didn't want to go to church anymore. And she said, I go to church, you'll go to church. And so... I was 13 and I was doing genealogy, right? I made her cry. So I made her, because I was doing genealogy, I asked where all of her siblings were, and she was like, well, they all died. And then I pressed her, I was like, how did they die? And she's like, stop talking to me. And she cried, and I made her cry, and I felt very sad. And then, since I was 13, I was just like, well, what was it like? What was it like, the genocide? And she said, well, for every 200 Armenians, there was one Turkish soldier who was in charge of that part of the line. And then she just stared at me, essentially daring me to ask, and I did. And I said, why didn't you guys just tackle them? There were so many more of you could have killed them and just tackled them. And she said, none of us wanted to be the first to die, so we all died. And the reason she told me that, because she wants me to be the first to die. I'm just gonna fucking tackle you guys. Nobody gets on the trains. Nobody. No. Anyway, so I saved the second funny story for last, because why not? Order of, I don't know how to do comedy. I do. The rule of three! The rule of three! Finish the fucking story. Here it is. She said as they were walked by these villages in Syria, the villagers would come out because they didn't have television. And they would ask, They would ask the women in line what their names were, and if you told them, they would go to the soldier in charge of that part of the line and buy you, and then you had to go with that dude. And my grandmother said that whenever the guys would ask her her name, she would throw rocks at them. And she told me that story when I told her I had a crush on a guy when I was 15, and it wasn't going well. And she said, yeah, we're not good with men, Jake. Some banana head said to him, hey, I bet you're not gay. You should totally find someone the opposite sex and try and do it. And they would just get drunk and then go do it and then wake up the next morning and go, yeah, no, that was not what I was looking for. And when I was in my 20s, gentlemen, you were not interested in this, or I could not tell. And one of my banana head friends said to me, hey, you're probably gay. And so I got drunk, and I went out into the world, and I found a lady, and we tried it. And then I woke up the next morning, and I was like, nope. That is not what I was looking for. I am going to need the pointy bit. So... this year, for the first time ever, I had surgery for the first time. I've never had surgery, because this has never broken down. This is old school peasant stock from all sides. This is literally like half Irish, half Armenian. It was genetically modified to pick up a rock on someone else's property. And move it to wherever that person wanted it. And then replicate myself twice and then fall over in a heap. That has not happened. I've dropped the ball. It was a basic outpatient surgery. A lot of ladies have it. I had a Pokemon up my uterus and they had to send a ball up. And because you gotta catch a ball. Gotta catch a ball. Here's the good news. Here's the good news about the Pokemon. A non-rare Pokemon up in my uterus. And so we're happy about that. So we caught it, got rid of it. But I was terrified, because I'm not brave. I've never had to be brave. And I wasn't. And then, so it made me start thinking about my body and my life and my mortality and all these things. And what you should know is that I have no idea what I look like. When I leave the hotel or my house, I have looked in the mirror, neck up, you guys. I brush my teeth, and then the front of my hair, and I head out. The clothes are clean, but that's it. If there's trouble, I get that from you.
We could use a few more suits around here.
Society has always been my mirror.
Rowdy.
And, you want to stiff up your power armor?
Hey, there's trouble.
I'll take a look.
And then
sure.
I fix it. And, but because of that, what I think I look like and what you see are two very different things. And I live in Los Angeles now, so I know kind of what you see because I know what Los Angeles sees. I go on a rare and wonderful audition, for example. And to pick three things, not at random, casting people in Hollywood clearly think this represents an airport cop, a PTA mom, or a German massage therapist for a Disney Channel show. And that is fine. I will play Beyonce's weird white aunt, by the way. I'd love to. I just want work. That's all I want. But that's not what I think I look like. I know I'm not pointy. I've never been pointy. I've looked some version of this since I was 16 years old.
Stay there.
So, give or take 20 pounds. On a good year of trying to be pointier, I can weigh 20 pounds less than this, I think. I don't own a scale. So, and there's no mystery why I'm not pointy. I mean, I don't eat fast food. I don't even eat a lot of sugar. I eat all the food that's given to me. Three times a day, I get a plate full of food, and I put it in my joke hole. It's the whole plan. There's no pointy people do not. They eat a third of the food, and then they get a box, and then they throw the box away. When I am from Wisconsin, it would be like lighting $6 on fire. And I say that, but I have tried to throw money at it. I've tried to throw money at it. Everyone wants to be pointy, and I've paid people into poking me into working out. This doesn't accelerate. And I've paid people to wrestling the food out of my face. I've done all the things that money can do. And then I was thinking about Oprah, you guys. Remember Oprah? She's back. Here's the thing about Oprah. No one has wanted to be pointier than Oprah. No one. No one. No one. And no one has more money to throw at it than frickin' Oprah. If you could be pointy by throwing money at it, Oprah would be the pointiest person on the planet. But think about Oprah for a second. This is what Oprah looks like. 30 years and $1 billion later, she looks like this, but she looks better than this because she has a team. A team. That's what I'm saving up for now. A team. Who wouldn't love a team? She's got a team to push her back into the house and say, comb the back of your hair. Why? Which cartoon shirt? What? And how great would we all look if we had a freaking team to just pour us into a rock tumbler every morning? Because that's what she's got. We would not be pointy, but we would be shiny and very smooth. It would be lovely. See, what I think I look like is I think I look like La Femme Nikita. I feel like La Femme Nikita. That's right. Very sexy, very dangerous. Or an 11-year-old boy who is going to grow up to be La Femme Nikita, you guys. That's what I feel like inside. But you don't grow up knowing you're La Femme Nikita. I'm the youngest of six. I have four older brothers and an older sister. And first time my father ever acknowledged I was a girl, I was 15. 15. He comes into the kitchen. I'm doing my homework. And he goes, all right, we're going to have the talk. The bee goes from flower to flower. The flower does not go from bee to bee. Guess which one you are. That was it. That was the extent of the lecture series on how to be a lady. Wasn't great. Was not great. My dad, I love my dad. My dad is a salesman. He loves to sell. He's 79 years old. He is retired, unless you would like to buy something. Because he loves selling things. He loves the sale. He loves the story. He loves the pitch. He loves, at the end of it, you will get very nice windows and aluminum siding and doors and roof. But he will also make as big a profit as he possibly can. Because it's a fun game for him. Okay, so I've had several moms. They're all dead. I didn't kill them. So here's the thing. So my mom died when I was 7. Like I said, I didn't kill her. You're familiar with the Irish goodbye when your mom kills herself in a drunk driving accident when you're 7? We all familiar with that? Does that feel too soon? Does it feel too soon? Usually only works with predominantly Irish crowds. So she did the best she could, in my opinion. She's great. But here's the thing. My dad remarried almost immediately, because that's what you do if you have six kids under the age of 17. That's what you do. You get remarried. You're like, oh, help. And my stepmother, my parents had been separated. My dad and my mom had separated. And my dad was living with the woman to become my stepmother for 3 years. And my father had never told her that he was married. He told her he was married. He never told her he had six children. And my dad, when he did tell her, Nancy said, you never told me. And my dad is the kind of guy who's like, no, I told you. Like, people forget that somebody has six kids that they're dating. And then get this, my stepmother married him, which of course makes her the best example of not to follow with men. Because she was amazing, and my grandmother always said that she saved our lives. Very possible, she was certainly a great loss to the Austrian army. There were charts and graphs and French corners on the beds, and there was a lot of chanting. There was some chanting, wash, wipe, and put away, live to eat another day. That was hers, that was hers. She never wanted kids. She used to tell us that when we were kids. Never wanted kids. She said, but we're doing this now. Now we're doing this. We're all doing this. You're going to be raised. You're going to have manners, and you're going to learn chores. And at the end of it all, we're going to love each other, and no one will know why. And so it came to pass, you guys. Yes. But a couple of years ago, she died, and that was super sad because she had raised me, and I was super sad about it because she was my mother. And, but my dad and my stepmother had been divorced for several years when she passed away, and my father was not invited to the funeral because my father is hilarious at funerals. Nobody wants that. So, nobody in my family knows how to deal with grief. I don't know if you remember the Irish goodbye joke. So, there's always, whenever anyone dies in my family, there's always someone who goes, yeah, people die, walk it off, get a cup of coffee. I'm 7. Put some sugar in it. So, there is, so Nancy dies, super sad, and I go home for the funeral. I take my dad to lunch because he's not coming to the funeral before, excuse me. And first thing my dad says is, you know, I'm going to die one day. And I was like, wow, nice work making it about you almost immediately. So I go to the funeral, and you know, if someone you love has died, the only person you want to talk to after the funeral is the dead person. And I wish I could have called my mom and just gone, oh my God, your brother. Your brother asked me for money moments from your body. Your sister showed up in robes, giant cross, robes. That's when I left, because that's when you would have left. But my dad did almost die a couple of years ago. Hey, spoiler alert, he does not die. He is alive. Here's the thing. But he's 76 years old. He had to have the heart surgery that you get when you're a million years old and have been smoking for 40 years. And so they go in, they clean out his heart, they close him up. So they have to open him up again, and then they close him up, and they've left something inside of him. They have to open him up a third time, and he does not die any of those times. But he keeps thinking, oh, I'm a dead person. And my brother, who lives in Milwaukee, is like, he's being such a wuss about it. He's like, no. No, he gets this one. He gets this one. But my brother, who lives in Milwaukee, his wife is a doctor. And she is not a people doctor. And in many ways, not a people person. She likes me, so I like her back. But she is she's not much of a people. Anyway, so every time he'd go under the knife, she would send a mass text message to me and my 5 siblings. Hey, they don't think he's going to make it. And so I started calling her the Angel of Death. So he has the first surgery. I fly back to Milwaukee. I drive to the VA. On the way to the VA, I get a text message from him, from the Angel of Death, and it says he's going under for a second surgery. They don't think he's going to make it. So I get to the hospital, and I talk to the nurse, and I was like, what the heck? And she goes, yeah, you know, we could have waited. We could have waited. He knew you were coming from the airport. And I said, if he didn't wait? And she goes, no, we asked him. He said, do you want to wait? And he goes, nah, let's just do it. And I said, well, did he have any last words or anything? And she goes, yeah, he said, tell her to do whatever she wants. I was like, those are the greatest last words ever. He should use those again. And I said, do you think he meant that in general or just today? And she goes, and she is also from Wisconsin and in the 21st century. So she said, well, if he lives, you should ask him. And I did. I did ask him. It was after his surgery, and he was all junked up on morphine or whatever, and I was like, hey, Dad, you said do whatever I want. Did you mean that in general or just that day? And he said, oh, in general. You should always do whatever you want. And I said, I suppose if it doesn't hurt anybody. And he goes, no, not even if it hurts people. It's like, it's an inside-your-head voice, pup. And so I fly away, and I am on... I'm on a flight, and I land here in Minneapolis, check my phone, very exciting, and so I check my phone, and I've gotten another message from the Angel of Death, and it says, hey, is he going in for a third surgery? He's getting the last rites. And so I call my sister, not my sister-in-law, I didn't want to talk to her that day, and so I call my sister, and I was like, is Dad gonna die? And she said, they don't know, I don't know. Maybe. And I said, well, I could be there in 5 hours. I could rent a car and be there in 5 hours. And she goes, yeah, you'll miss it. He'll either live or die. He'd want you to work. And so I went to North Carolina and told jokes instead. And he did. He lived. At that same time, my brother, who lives in Milwaukee, got that text message. He was in a meeting with 2 lawyers for the Koch brothers, right? They're obviously working on an elixir made of the poor. And, but he's sitting there in this meeting... And he gets the same text message I got, and he's looking at it, and one of the lawyers says, is everything okay? And my brother goes, oh, my dad's getting the last rites. And the lawyer goes, oh, do you want to reschedule? And my brother goes, no, let's just do it.
And the lawyer says, that's a little cold. Lawyer for the Koch brothers called my brother a little cold. But he lived. My dad lives. He goes home, and a month and a half after he gets back to his apartment, he falls down and breaks his leg. And now he's back in the hospital, and so I fly to Milwaukee, and I'm like, I can't take it, Dad. I can't take it. You're dying. You're not dying. You're dying. You're not dying. It's driving me. And he looks up from the hospital bed, and he goes, nice work making it about you almost immediately. The jackass does not fall that far from the tree, my friends. And I didn't have any friends. I didn't have any friends as a kid. I had a lot of siblings. Plenty of people to hang out with, but no friends. I had an imaginary friend for too long, too long. Yeah, I met Steve when I was 7. He was 11. He had a motorbike. We had a lot of good times, you guys. Yeah. Here's how you know that you've had an imaginary friend for too long, is when he becomes your imaginary lover. Yes, I was 14. He was 18. It was about to become statutory. He knew better. He knew better. We had a last weekend in the Alps, and then he blew off. And, But here's how I found out about friendship. When I was 14, my sister, who was a year and a half older than I am, and it turns out is the boss of me, she made me go out for the basketball team. And not to play basketball, but to get friends. And I was doing laps like you do when you go out for a basketball team. And I was reading a book like I did when I did anything when I was 14, as I was an early adopter of some antisocial behavior. And the coach comes over and she goes, no running and reading, no reading and running. What the hell is going on? Please pick someone from the team to run with. And I said, boo-hoo, no one wants to run with me. I don't have any friends. And she looked at me like adults have always looked at children. When children have come to them and you've had to say, oh, childhood. Can't fix it. You're screwed. And then, get this, she fixed it. She, the coach, looks at me and she goes, you don't have any friends? And I said, no friends. And she goes, are you friendly? No. Oh my gosh, no. Did you miss the book? It was nonfiction. It was about the Civil War, and she took time out of her very busy life to draw a line graph in the dirt of the track and explain friendship to me. She goes, all right, here we are at the beginning of the line graph. This is how you start getting friends. Start talking to people. Eye contact would be great, but any kind of mumbling will get you acquaintances. After a certain amount of time, you'll get to the middle of the graph. This is some of those people will have made it here. Those will be your friends. You will support them. They will support you. It's very beautiful. That's where it's happening. Here at the end of the line graph, this isn't friendship. This isn't happening. You're going through their garbage. You're reading their text messages. Leave them alone. Leave them alone. Okay. To this day, that line graph is why I have friends. And I'll tell you something, it did not give me boyfriends. It did not give me, it got me male friends. Boyfriend graph, that's a different graph. That is a bar graph or a pie graph or a histogram. We don't know what that is. Because I did not have a boyfriend. I wasn't good at it. I didn't know how to do it. If I liked a guy, this is how I'd hit on guys. I'd stand next to them for years. It is not great. It's not good. It does not get you dates. And, But then, the best invention, online dating. And I got a fella, and he's good at it. He's a game designer. He makes video games for a living, and it's amazing. But I don't know anything about being in a relationship. He's my first relationship. We got married 10 years ago, and I was 100 when we got married. And so, but the thing is so I still don't, every day I wake up, and I'm like, have I broken it? And he's like, no. And, we go forth with that, because all I know about being in a relationship, I know from my cuckoo bird parents, mixed reviews there, not great, and male comics, often on there too. So, because guys, I've been hearing jokes for 30 years of doing stand-up about being in a relationship, so that's how I know what not to do or what to do, is guys that are right? And, so one of the jokes in the 90s was, women are always asking us what we're thinking about. We're not thinking about anything. Stop asking. I'll tell you if I'm thinking about something. Stop asking. So I never asked my boyfriend who became a husband what he was thinking about. Never did. Never did. Why? Because I was told not to. And then 3 years into our relationship, which means we had been married for a year and a half, we're in the car and he turns to me and says, what are you thinking about? He asked me. And I said, comedy, what are you thinking about? And he said, games. And it was the last time we had that.
Because that is all he is thinking about. And that is all I am thinking about. Sometimes male comics are right. Anyway. But he's a game designer, so everything's a game. So, I don't know. You know when you go to, a holiday event or a work event or a family event that you do not want to go to? And you say to your partner, hey, this is not going to be fun. Will you please come with me? He is an adult man who has had short-term relationships and long-term relationships like a person, so he knows how to be in a relationship. And he would always say to me, he's always said, hey, this isn't going to be fun, but please come and I will use you as a pick and it will be more bearable. And I have always said, of course, I would love to be a this relationship will allow me to be part of the solution. But I never asked him to go because I always thought to myself, well, I don't even fucking want to go to this thing. Why would I bring the guy that I like the best to the thing I don't want to go to? Until about 2 months ago when I had a small, tiny meltdown. And I said to him in this tone of voice, please come with me to the thing I don't want to go to. And he looked at me and he goes, of course. Why didn't you just ask? And I said, I didn't want to be a burden. And he did something that I recommend you do if you're ever in a relationship with me. he laughed in my face. He didn't laugh at me, he just laughed. And he goes, I'm pretty sure that's what marriage is. We're a burden on each other. And then he said, because he's a game designer, he said, I got a game. Here's the game, maybe. Every time you think you're being a burden on me, give me a dollar. And every time I think I'm being a burden on you, I'll give you a dollar. And I promise you, we will never need another fucking dollar. We will trade that dollar back and forth for the next 40 years. And I said, well, you are adorable, but that game sounds boring. And he said, we would have to play test it. Because everything's a game. Everything's got a game mechanic. Everything's got a game design. He literally, I get text messages from him from different places. A couple of years ago, got a text message from the grocery store. All it said was, the user interface here is broken. I don't know how long I'll be at the grocery store. So I called him up and I said, what's the user interface at the grocery store? And he says, the line. It should be one line, like at the bank, but it has many lines. So I don't know if I've chosen correctly. I don't know how long it's going to be. And I said, well, I'll be hanging up. But my favorite one was last year. He went to his first ever strip joint. I have been hanging out with dirtbags for 30 years and have been to many strip joints. He had never been to a strip joint before because every other bachelor party he had been to had been a board game bachelor party. Yeah, not crummy board games, good board games, right? Settlers, Ticket to Ride, Pandemic, get out there, treat yourself right. Here's my current favorite party game. It's called Bring Your Own Book. It's like apples to apples. It's quite nice. And now that that unsolicited ad is over, I will continue. Now, so he goes to the strip, he's gonna go, I get a text message and it says, hey, I'm in time for the bachelor party. We're going to a strip club, I'm gonna go look at boobs. And so I texted him back and I said, well, come home to mine later, have a good time. And right after that, I get a text from him and it says, what game is this? So I called him and I said, it's not a game, it's noodly ladies being noodly. That's the whole game. And he said, oh no, there's a game here. There's a lot of in-game purchasing. Yes, there is. And then he said, I don't like it. I said, well, delete the app. Get the fuck out. But he knows things, right? A couple of months ago, we were sitting around, and so we're sitting around, and he says, out of the blue in the living room, hey, you know, sometimes when you're in a relationship for a long time, the mystery can be lost from that relationship. And I just want you to know that I was just staring at you from across the room, and I was thinking to myself, what the fuck is she doing? So you guys, I still got it! He gave me moccasins for Christmas last year. You guys, moccasins. I've always wanted moccasins. But I'm the youngest of six. When there are six children in your family, there aren't a lot of novelty shoes. So I'd never had moccasins before, but he got me moccasins. But he didn't just get me moccasins. He also got me a bow and arrow. A real bow and arrow with a quiver and moccasins and a knife. I got a Hunger Games kit for Christmas, and it was the greatest gift I've ever received. And with it, I received the gift of insight, you guys. The gift of insight. I did not know this. I did know it, but I didn't know that I knew. But I did know why banana heads want to openly carry their guns. We all know why. And it is because... Now, think about walking around with a gun on you. That's awesome. Think about Sneaky Pete. Think about conceal and carry. Sneaky Pete, your gun, right? Nobody even knows you have it. Think about a derringer on your forearm. No, I don't have a gun. Wait a minute. Plus, I have at least 3 friends who collect swords. Swords! Full-on swords. Broadsword. Katana. Rapier. 3 people in my life who would love to openly carry their sword. Strap a sword on, head out into the world. And if you ask them, why are you wearing your sword? They would not say, because it is cool, even though that is why, and they are correct. They would say, I need it for protection. But even gun people know that's ridiculous, because a sword, of course, is a melee weapon. And you're never going to get a booth at a Denny's. So... But here's how I found out about it. I got my Hunger Games kit for Christmas. I put it on. Mox, knife, quiver, bow in hand. Monday morning, beautiful, sunny Los Angeles, heading out the front door. Los Angeles, California, into my Corolla. Bow in hand. And my husband says to me, where are you going? And I said, errands. And he said, please, no. Then he explained it. What he did. He said, it's only cool for you. You're going to make everyone uncomfortable at the grocery store. You don't need your bow and arrow at the grocery store. You're safe. Safe, dangerous thing at a grocery store? GMO pancake mix. You're good. I was thinking about time travel the other day because of my moccasins, because I think people are very smart, and we will one day invent time travel. But I also think people are the dumbest, and that's how we're going to extinct ourselves. We're just going to line up like the lemmings that we are in front of time travel machines and say stuff like, I wonder what real pirates were like. Dead off. Dinosaurs? Dead. Oh my god, I want to kill Hitler. Dead. I want to stop slavery. Dead. I wonder what Pompeii was like 3 days before. Oh, shut up. Here's what I want to do with a time travel machine. I want to go back 1,000 years and see old growth forests in Wisconsin. That's what I want to see, right? But even though I own moccasins, I don't know how to camp. Yeah, so what's going to happen is I'm going to go back in time and die of exposure. It's going to be very beautiful. I took my husband with me, to a gig outside of Los Angeles at an Indian casino. Things are going well. So we go to the Indian casino, and we're driving, and we park, and he says, you know the one thing that makes me sad about the Indian casino? And I said, the one thing? Wow, what could it be? What's the sad thing about Indian casinos? And he said, the fact that there's no Native American restaurants at the Indian casino. How great would that be, a Native American restaurant at the Indian casino? And all I could think was, wow, you know, as an affluent white couple, if we could just find a couple of Indians and go, could you guys do one more thing for us? Yeah. Well, how many burgers, some fried bread to go? No, you're good? Okay, there's a reason, my fellow Americans, why there are no Native American restaurants at the Indian casino, and it's because we are a melting pot, a pot of meltingness. Everyone takes their ethnic food, we put it in the melting pot, brings us closer together. It's very beautiful. Then we do a very American thing where we pick up the melting pot and we put it in the frozen food aisle. Now, I don't know if you know any Native Americans. You should. You live in the largest Native American urban population in the country. I do. There you go. There's a couple right there. Or not. But whatever. I do. Turns out, they do not wish to melt. They're still angry. And I get it. I'm sympathetic, but not supportive, because no one is moving. So here's what I want them to do. I want them to take that rage and make a frozen food line, a boxed food line. That's what I want them to do, because once frozen, it's no longer ethnic food. Well, one's frozen. It is American food once it is frozen. A frozen taquito has not seen a Mexican woman in 100 years. Every 6-year-old in the world knows what they are, and they love them. They love them. Brings us closer together. The frozen food aisle, already a trophy case to American imperialism. It's already happened. So here's what I wanted to do. Take that rage, make it into a frozen food line, a boxed food line. All the profits could buy land. Who cares? They could call it Manifest Destiny. And every product could be just a rage-filled poke in the eye with a history lesson attached to it. Oh, is there some reason you don't want to buy Trail of Tears mix that make you upset? Pigs in a smallpox blanket make you sad for some reason? How about just a case of sitting Red Bull? I have a dozen of these. Sack at your Wheaties. But here's how I know that it works, right? A couple of years ago, I'm in Weirdo, Indiana, and talking to an old white guy. And in the course of that conversation, old white guy says to me, hey, have you ever had this pod Thai? Have you ever had this Thai food pod Thai? And I said, yeah, I have. Have you ever had pod Thai? And he goes, yeah, yeah, I had a Lean Cuisine pod Thai. It was nice. It was like spaghetti, but with peanuts. Yes, yes, it was. That's exactly what it was from Lean Cuisine, my friend. And then he said, I bet you those Thai people are some real nice Oriental people, those Thai people. We stared at each other for a second. And then he said, I don't think I'm supposed to say Oriental. So we can all be taught, is what I am saying. I love people. My favorite thing that happened in Los Angeles last year, 3 different women about my age, let's go with 47. Have said out loud in my ears, in my hearing, 3 different coffee shops, 3 different women about my age have said out loud, why is it so hard for me to have a baby? 47. Now, the short answer, of course, is science. The long answer, of course, is also science. But we can talk about it. I get it. If you're 47 years old, let me tell you something. That's when you're ready to have a baby. Emotionally, financially, you're like, oh, I could probably handle it now. And, like a lot of guys who have kids in their 40s, you've had a lovely career, and you kind of want to stack a kid up that looks like you, tell them all about it. And I get it. I have never wanted children in my life. I like them. I have a dozen nieces and nephews. The jackass gene runs true. There's no need for me to get involved. My mother started having kids when she was 16. Had me at 26. Died at 33. Yeah, the age of Christ. Coincidence? Yes. You meet them, like 3-4-year-old girls who are pad batting around screaming, I want a baby, and you gotta get that kid a doll or they never shut up. And I remember when I was 3 or 4 and I would meet those little girls and I would think, you're a baby, we're babies, you can't have a baby, you're gonna break it. I never wanted a baby, I never did. When I was 4 years old, I wanted moccasins and the fuck out of Wisconsin. That's what I wanted. But then I met my husband and I fell in love. And it has to be a visceral genetic reaction because I fell in love with them. And I was like, that clearly needs to be perpetuated. I need one of them. Stat. And it's not going to happen, right? I have 4 eggs. They're marinating in extra chromosomes. But it's not just me. He's been sitting on his cell phone and his testicles for 12 years. It's not all my fault, right? We're not what Jeff Goldblum was thinking when he said life finds a way. We've made peace.
Yeah.
We're gonna leave up, go to Paris, sleep in forever. And I am. The aging process is coming along. You know what's gonna happen next? The Terrigen Mists. I'm about to get the Terrigen Mists, you guys. The big change. I'm either gonna get a superpower or get turned into like a pile of ash. And for those of you not following the Marvel Inhumans, that's middle-aged lady time. Choo-choo! Middle-aged lady time's coming around the mountain, and I'll tell you something, nobody wants to talk about it. I know that. It reminds me a lot of my initial lady time, which also nobody wanted to discuss. Here's what I would have loved to have heard from my stepmother when I was 13. Hey, that's an applicator. But here's what happened. I went to the doctor, and I was like, middle-aged lady time's coming. What's it going to be like? What's going to happen? And she says, nobody knows. What do you mean, nobody knows? And she said, well, your period could just stop, or it could spread out, be every 3 months, or it could tighten up, be every 2 weeks, or it could be on and off and on and off and on and off. And I was like, yeah, that's all the choices, Crazy Magoo. What are you talking about? How can nobody know? And she said, because every woman's a snowflake. I don't want to be a snowflake. I want to be a cog in a machine. I want you to go to the hardware store and buy a socket set. And I want there to be two choices, metric or English. That's what I want. That's what I want. And I said, how long does Gropey last? How long does Gropey Magoo hang around? And she said, anywhere between a year and a half to 4 years. And I went and told my husband that, and we stared at each other in horror. But I finally understand why 50-year-old dudes are like, awesome. Whatever's happening here, gotta not watch it. And, again, I am sympathetic, but not supportive. So, if you like to read, I'm a big reader. I used to read all the time when I was little. And then when I was 13, I had library funds. Library funds. Dastard. Awful. When they hit $10, you were no longer allowed to take any more books out of the library. And so I freaked out. Small freak out. Couldn't find $10. And I started shoplifting books from Kmart. And the only reason I tell you that is because the quality of what you're reading goes down when you start reading only books from Kmart. I have read all of Louis L'Amour's works, for example. I've read all of the Spencer for Hire novels, a lot of Merc books about Africa, and every Harlequin romance from the late 70s and early 80s. Now, but then I got caught shoplifting, but again, tiny white child. So the cops made me write a paper. You gotta write a paper about the effect of shoplifting on small businesses like Kmart. And and I told my sister about that. My sister is the kind of person that has been reading the Wall Street Journal since she was 9. So she was very excited about this paper. She loves a paper, and she loves the economy. And she was like, oh, my gosh, this is going to be the greatest paper. We're going to write this paper, the effect of shoplifting. And all I could think was, you have a library card. And so we wrote a paper that was probably amazing, and the Cudahy Police Department threw away. So, but the point of this whole story is that I still, I like to read good books. I like to read about history. I like to read beautifully researched historical fiction, and sometimes I like to read poorly researched and poorly written historical romance novels. And I only tell you that because you can't count on the information you get from a historical romance novel or any novel. I wouldn't try to get around Boston with a Spencer for Hire, right? I wouldn't try to solve your problems with the underage sex teen whatever with a Jack Reacher novel. I don't recommend it. But here's the scoop. I was reading a romance novel recently, and my protagonist was studying an ancient document describing tantric sex moves. Tantric sex, of course, the bendy sex. Now, were they really tantric sex? We don't know. I was reading it, and here was one of the moves. This was the move I liked, which was 9 short strokes, 1 long stroke. 8 shallow strokes, 2 deep strokes, 7 and 3, 6 and 4, 5 and 5, 4 and 6, 3 and 7, until you do 10 deep long strokes. You know what I'm talking about. Okay, there we go. So I read this, and I think to myself, I, Jackie Cation, would like to try this move. And I got a fella at the house, right? We're constantly doing it, me and him. Sanctioned by God, the government. And so one time, me and him are going at it, we're doing it, and I think, oh, I want to try the thing. But he has not read the book. And I did not tell him the move. And I just took over the reins a little bit. He's a good sport. And so we're going at it. 9 and 1, 8 and 2, 7 and 3, 6 and 4, 5 and 5, 4 and 6, until you do 10 deep, long strokes. It's supposed to make the sex last longer, and everybody's supposed to have a good time. And so it came to pass. Thank you for asking. It was lovely. But afterwards, we were cuddling like you do. And we're cuddling, and I said, did you notice the thing I did in the sack right there? Because I'm super romantic. And he said, yeah, I was there. It was you and me. What was it? And I said, it might have been tantric sex. We don't know. I read about it in a book. And then I explained the long and the short of it to him. And then he said, well, I'm glad you didn't tell me about it, because I might have wanted to take the reins back. And then I would have wanted to do 3 short strokes, 3 long strokes, 3 short strokes, and then paused. 3 short strokes, 3 long strokes, 3 short strokes, and then paused. three short strokes, three long strokes, three short strokes, and then you would have been like, oh my gosh, he's in trouble. And then I had to go look up Morse code for SOS. And he was in trouble. He was drowning in my sweet, sweet cauldron of love. You guys are great. I hope you had fun, because I love doing it. So thanks a lot, you guys. Take care of each other out there.
Say goodbye.
Radiohead cover, I imagine. And hi, Z. I'll tell you in a second. Idiot. Attack. IDOTEQUE. So if that's a Radiohead song, I don't know. It's off an album called Best of College Acapella. So, nerd. I think that's the. Word we're looking for. Jenny Miller, hey! I love Radiohead's early work. Honestly, I don't know. And finishing one of the last three buildings. Now Now, if you ask me about the band Jellyfish, I can tell you all about the band Jellyfish. No, I can't. But I have both of their albums, and I did get to meet them once. And if they have more than two albums, then I really don't know them at all. Tips for someone who sucks at settlement building? Ooh. Yeah. Tips for settlement building, I guess. Well, for me, I've had an architectural background-ish. Not really. I've had a drafting background, and I know how to build things. Things settlers want and need. I guess that's the one way to look at it. And things that make settlers happy. So, this is the stupidest fucking thing I've ever done, but... Alright, so these are the things that residents use and need and stuff. So, you need... let's go from the bounty... Reactor, you need power, you need food, hydroponics, you need places, covered rooms with beds in them for them to sleep. Big tip, I think, is that residents kind of prefer to sleep together in a big social setting. Whether it's like a large room with four beds in it, or eight beds, or a large room with all 25 beds, or 20 beds, or however many residents are in the area. Lavatory, that's a mod that I'm using, so regular settlements on the vanilla game don't care about bathrooms. Maintenance, when I have that written down, that's for like your stations where you can your power armor station, your tool station, your armor station, your lab station, your cooking station. All those need to be built at every settlement. Whether you're going to use them there or not, they need to be built. Clinic is something new. Well, is somewhat new. Some of the new additions that they added to the game, which is the, I can show that in a second, hang on. I'll show Clinic in a second. You need the stores. Your trader store, which I have marked as loot. Guns, clothing, armor. Clothing and trader are the only one that bring happiness, so those are more important than armor and guns. Research, I don't remember why I put that there. There's a new barber chair and cafeteria. You need to have... That's the other store, the bar store. Let's show you the clinic real quick. This is my... where my... The bar and... food's going to be. So the bartender's going to be here. The casino's going to be up here, or the bar's going to be up here, and the casino's going to be down here. One or the other, I'm not sure. And then down below is clearly where all the beds are. Again, shitload of beds, all in one place, because I don't know if it makes them happy or not, but it seems that it makes it easy to get people happier faster if they're all together in one big room. I've tried it many other ways, and they're kind of just grumpy assholes in other means. So I have a clinic, so I have two clinics because this is a raider station and it's my new idea for settlements, but you got the new four opterer station and you got the new surgery chair. This is what I mean by having a clinic. And in this settlement, this is where my bathroom's going to be, but that's not important. That's where the power is right now. I just made it pretty. I don't know why. Down this way is where the selling will be. All the clothing store, the armor, the trader, and the gun store will all be here. There's a big shopping promenade thing, whatever. Down this way is how you get to the barber chair, again, which also brings happiness. And for me, I'm going to have all the tools and maintenance and, if you will, all the armor stations and stuff like that over here. A major setup of it. I have to fix this. This hallway's too long. Part of the Wasteland Workshop lets you build these cages, which will capture certain animals, and then you can provide fights and stuff for your settlers to watch. I don't necessarily recommend this, but that's what I'm doing here, is this kind of thing. So I have some, these are deathclaw cages and some, well, a lot of deathclaw cages. God, I'm not original. Oh well. But this is the arena. That second level up there is where they're gonna watch the show from. So you can't get these gorillas until after you've destroyed the Institute and allowed the people to escape in the game. But there's a mod that is allowing me to get the gorillas sooner than later. And so I think I got like 12 gorillas now, or maybe 14, just roaming the island. And oddly, each gorilla produces security. So right now my defense is 164. And these are only producing 12. And 12. So that's 24. So 164 minus 24 gives me 140. So that's 14 gorillas that are giving me happiness and security. They just walk around. You can also build cages for dogs and cats, which I'll be also building. and make and populate this island with a shitload of cats and dogs and gorillas. stupid. But anyway, here's one of the smallest settlements that should be back to... Oh, it's so close. Here's a compact version of a settlement, and it's normally at 100% happiness, but there was a glitch in the game the other day, and it's taken a while for them to get back up to 100% happiness, because I'm not artificially making them happy, if you will, because you can do that. You can artificially give happiness to your settlement by pommel horses produce happiness as well. So just build a shitload of pommel horses, like 40, 50 pommel horses, and shove it under a rock or something, you know, with a rug glitch. Oh, wait a minute. You gotta see this from the road. I had one concept for this. One idea. And all you need is an idea. My idea was I wanted to have a treehouse. There you go, treehouse. So, where are you going to put all the crap for a treehouse? Using some rug glitches and just throw it all in the center. I have the water pumps and the generators and stuff in the center of the tree, which is all hollow. And it has to be hollow because the stairs, they wouldn't walk up the stairs if it wasn't hollow. I don't know why. But I have all the workstations available for them. I got these guys
running things, giving away a party. Life's too short, boss.
Doing the boost still for
the
raiders.
Who the alphas are.
This is a regular settlement, clothes shop, and that's the raiders settlement clothes shop. So normal settlers, and raiders. Normal settlers, raider. Raider, normal settler, raider. He's doing the barber shop, but with raiders, I can't go up to him and ask him, hey, I want a haircut. No, because it's not a normal settlement. It'll still provide happiness, and he'll still stand there with a freaking clipboard and do the job, and they are fine with it, but you can't use them. Raider settle, chem store, regular doctor clinic. Notice the difference.
You ain't standing out. You ain't worth
he's
looking at.
He's just pushing drugs.
That dominates.
This one over here thinks he's a doctor and he's going to treat you, but he won't act like that. All he does is act like a raider pushing drugs. And because my because my charisma is... No, not that. Here. Because my charisma is at 13, raider settlements are your charisma plus 10. So whatever your charisma is, it's charisma plus 10. And I'm an idiot, and I used a cheat, and I grabbed a couple extra bobbleheads because I was making a display of bobbleheads and I was just moron, fucking moron. So my charisma is at 13. And so I have 23 people here, so that's what you get, your charisma plus 10. So I had enough jobs for everybody, except I needed to add two more jobs because normally it's only 21, because the most you can have is 11 on your charisma. So the most you could be is 21. No, because I'm an idiot. I'm at 23. So that guy back there and that guy back there are both chem stores, but they're... I just needed to put them somewhere. He's the doctor, but he won't act like a doctor. This guy's doing the four-opter job, and he's fine with it, but you can't talk to him. You can still use the four-opter chair. These guys are doing
the pack is alpha now.
The vault soda the machines, and they're fine with it. And it provides
and
happiness.
Smart to go asking about it.
And you go upstairs to one large room. This is just kind of the thing that settlers want. They want to be together. They want to be... they don't want to be spread out doing things. They want to be doing things together, if you will. So I just went ahead and put everything back up here. And again, all the beds, one large area. I gave them bathtubs and that's the toilet mod. And the toilets actually bring happiness too. Lots of places to eat. Oh, it's quitting time. Look, so they're all coming upstairs. And now they're going to relax. This is what happens. If you ever watch your settlers, this is what happens.
If you're wearing a collar, it's because you asked for it.
Maybe.
No one's a slave that don't want to be.
Don't talk to me. So this is what they do. They come back upstairs after their thing, and then they'll go sit and relax and do something.
Hard not to preen when you're the best, ain't it?
I know, lady. Let's just look at him from above. It's easier. All right, so down below you have a grub station, which is food for the regular settlers, and the booze station, which is the bar for the raiders. And again, the Nuka...
Sun's going down.
Machine.
Be a little easier to sneak up on folks now.
Uh-huh. And they're going to use the slot machines. You can see them sitting down at the tables. They're using the, what do you call it? The pommel horses. And they'll use the weight benches as well. Now, if I sat here and waited long enough... Hang on a second. They go to bed at midnight. So, 9:30, 10:30, 11:30. Let's go 4 hours. All right, so we go 4 hours.
Rise and shine, boss.
And you better... If you sleep in one of the beds... If you have a bed at the settlement, make sure it's a bed that is not already occupied. If you... You know... I know this bed is not being used. And they go to bed. They all fucking go to bed. I swear too much. I'm sorry. Slightly. They all have beds. They all go to bed. It's what they do. They like sleeping in large beds. I mean, like this. Bam! Everyone's asleep. Happy! Sorry. I mean, it's science. Well, I mean, it's just the way the game works. I'm going to give him a little treat. I'm going to make some gorillas for here. Why not? Because they should have more happiness. And gorillas produce happiness. What the hell? This place was perfectly set for happiness for 21 people. But now that I have 23 people, it's freaking harder to have happiness. And it's a raider settlement, so I just put the thing there. I don't know. It's like putting Legos together. If it snaps together, it goes together. You know, things need to be a box, so just make a boxes. Just make boxes. And or whatever shapes you can. Here. Coastal Cottage. They all have 23 now, which sucks. Your wedding ring gives you a +1 charisma, and I was wearing also something else that gave me a +1 charisma. So this was up to 25 before, so I had... that was horrible. And this is what you do with power armor. You steal the cores from, the fusion cores from, Brotherhood of Steel, and then you stack them on telephone poles.
Ha ha ha.
Alright, hang on a second. That's the trick! Preston doesn't know about him yet. Preston doesn't exist to me yet. Preston is still trapped in Concord. I have not met Preston. This is the trick. You have to do Nuka World before you meet Preston. How can you do that? By meeting Nick, meeting Curie, meeting McCready, meeting everyone else first. Meet Strong. Do crap with Strong. Gain his full affinity. Gain Curie's full affinity. Gain Cait's full affinity. Gain, you know, everyone else. Gain all your non-faction companions' full affinity. And then, you know, do the DLC for Far Harbor. That's what I've done. Automatron. Nuka World, which I'm in the middle of. I still haven't met... Preston, Dance, or the Railroad. I still haven't met Volatech yet either. And I'm at whatever level I'm at. 116 now. Granted, I'm kind of cheating, getting a lot of extra materials from loot chests, but that's just because I wanted to finally have a full-on pretty settlement. I like to just keep these. I think those are pretty, so I just want to keep it visible. I don't know why. This is one of my. This is my second settlement, and that's why there's way too many of those guys. A whole bunch of chems, and more chems, dealers, outfits. There's three outfit dealers. Four junk, gear, trash, and crap dealers. Again, you need to have the stations always around. Booze, light booze, more booze, and girly drinks.
He does the girly drinks, because that's funny.
If it ain't the big bad overboss, couldn't have shown up a year ago, huh?
Uh-huh. So I have the generators tucked behind here. So it's easier just to have them out of the way. If they're out of the way behind walls that you can't get to, better. Because that means someone can't throw a grenade and destroy it when you're attacked. And these things create a whole bunch of happiness. Then I have, just a bunkhouse over here, where everyone's beds are in one area. Simple. Oh, it's because he's wearing outfits on outfits, and I'm at the... Oh, technically? Here, this is funny. Your outfit can dictate the shape of your character. It gives me charisma. I can't put that on. Okay, here's the officer's uniform. Hang on a second. Sorry. I love the jetpack perk. To me, the jetpack perk is adding double jump to the game. So this is in one outfit. But my character's built like this, all right? So look at the side of the character. See the waist, how much it's, what size it is, right? Now when I put back on the furry pants and t-shirt, wife beater, whatever. Notice how the waist got skinnier? So it's kind of like an optical illusion. It makes it look like my character's a lot bigger. And actually does kind of make my character a little bit bigger, but it just cinches the waist more to the point, you know? So, yeah, that's why my characters look like that. I'm using a mod that lets me layer up crap. So they're just basic shapes, just basic boxes, but you just gotta remember to have the things that make people happy. I mean, the other version of my... So, I went from Outpost Zimunja to Coastal Cottage, Croup Manor, which they're getting back up to 100% as well. Taffington Boathouse is the place that supplies everything. Robots need beds. If you have the Automatron DLC and you build robots, robots need beds. They won't sleep in them, but they need beds. That's also more of a tip. I think creativity is just everyone copying somebody else with the occasional brilliance of something new. This is what I did with the drive-in. I don't build fences and walls anymore because they're pointless. Your settlers will walk outside those walls. Your walls mean nothing for defense. You know, they don't protect your settlement at all. So why build them? It's a waste of your resources. Spend your resources on turrets. It's a subsidiary of Nuka Cola. That's just my joke. See, I built on top of the wings because I wanted it to look like a spaceship for their restaurant casino area because it's the Starlight Drive-In. It's got that little flying saucer on top. Might as well have a flying saucer restaurant.
Respect around here, you gotta earn it. Of course. Handing over new abodes hasn't hurt.
That's the power armor wall for some fucking reason. Every version of the power armor that you can have in the game, plus a mod that gives Raider power armor some different colors and choices. Gunners, Atom Cats, Railroad, Minutemen, Institute, Sentinel, Paladin, Knight of the Brotherhood of Steel, Overboss, Automatron DLC's Tesla Power Armor. Just putting together what fits. These bottom halves are just the roof turned backwards. Which you do that by putting down a wall facing the wrong way underneath where you know it's going to go. I've seen other people have high rises in their settlements, but I've never seen their settle. They give these tours of their high rises that they've built, and the characters aren't up the stairs and don't go walking around. So this is the first high rise. Well, this is the high rise I built, and it's fully in use. See, they use these things. They like to lounge around and do stuff after work is done. The people at the booze and bar, they don't stop working till after at midnight, basically. That's when they close. And then they'll all come back up here and go to sleep. Granted, this one, they're not all in the same area, but they're all in the same building. And they do all go to sleep.
We'll take care of the territory, boss. After all, you put it in good hands.
Hell yeah, lady. All right. And they're up here using the equipment up here. I'm just saying it's... If you don't watch your settlers to see if they'll use something, what's the point of building it? So all these settlements that I've seen that other people build are... Oh, they're pretty, but they're not useful in the game. You know, granted, it's awesome you can build it, but what for? And we are... I don't want to get too close. Yeah, I'm on the PlayStation. So you're limited with some mods that you can have, but you can't get on the... You can get it on the PC and the Xbox, but you can't get it on the PlayStation. See, Preston's still there. I haven't run into him yet. Better get away before I don't want to trigger it yet. The next thing after I get this last settlement built is I will go to all the regular settlements before I meet Preston and build them up. Fix them to be 100% happy, take care of all their needs, so that when I meet Preston, he won't send me on all these stupid little missions. Alright, so this is creativity gone wrong. I didn't want to have any human settlements supplying the raiders of Nuka World, so I used Jezebel, put her in a settlement, and that settlement is supplying Nuka World. Later, Z. Next time I'll have more a cappella of possible Radiohead songs. I have no idea. So using Jezebel and created robots from the Automatron DLC in a settlement to create food and supply Nuka World. This is what I came up with. This is the Taffington Boathouse.
Identity confirmed.
No, don't talk to me, peoples. But I can't use the settlement anymore, so it's stuck in this position like I've made it. Ugh. Jezebel's Juke Joint, loosest slots around, home of the heavy pour, featuring the comedy of Shecky Green, Ghoul, 300th straight year. I think that's a great joke. Besides, no one knows who Shecky Green is except me. Well, and anybody else who's, like, really old, or whatever. And that's what I did to Jezebel. I didn't give her any arms or armor, and I just only gave her a Mr. Handy Thruster, so she's just kind of like stuck floating all the time.
Who did I piss off to get this detail?
I had made this place ready for, I was going to have all robots supplying all the stores and stuff, but I couldn't get the happiness up. The happiness couldn't get up to 100. So I left these jobs unattended. There's someone doing the clinic, but that's it. All these other jobs are not being attended to, and so. But I was at 100% happiness before I stopped. Before I started. I had it taken over as Nuka World. And this is my player home for the settlement, if you will. But like I said before, every robot needs to have a bed. So when I redid the barn, this barn, I put all the robot beds up here. They don't need to get to the beds. They're not going to sleep in them. So just put them out of the way. Game Sand Tech. Hi. Can you get Sanctuary as a Raider settlement before you meet Preston? I don't know. I've never tried. If you can sit through three load screens, we'll find out. We'll go ask what's-his-face if we can run a settlement job. I'm guessing no.
Hey.
You hear something? Anything?
Check it out.
I'm gonna make a quick save over here before I head out. This is so impossible, but who cares? I just needed for me to look at back at the settlement. Quick save. Let's head over to Nuka World and see if we can get Sanctuary as a settlement. Musical interlude for a moment. Well, get a drink of water. Hey, Johnny, Samuel Rickmuth, hi Samuel, anyway, I can't show you on this map, I can show you on this though, here, I don't have any companions at Sanctuary because I don't have Sanctuary as a settlement. See? No Sanctuary. It's from Best of College Acapella. I don't know where, when. You can tell you in a second. Yeah, OMG, by the Boston College Bostonians, from 2012. Anyway, let's go find out if,
Boss, what can I do for you?
I'm interested in running a job.
Yeah. What kind of job we talking here?
It's time we took over another settlement.
Sure thing, boss. You gonna talk to them yourself? Or should I get a crew to help you put them in the dirt?
Get a gang together. I want a clean house.
Will do. And which gang you want to join you on the job?
Samuel, if I sub, will something show up? A sense of pride, I guess? Does that make sense? I don't get paid for this, and I don't know how many subscriptions I have, because...
Just gonna leave me in the lurch here, boss? The pack. I'll give them a heads up. So, where do you want to hit?
But I don't get any notifications about people subscribing. Yeah, I can't even... Sanctuary Hills is grayed out. So is the, Grey Garden. But after I finish this settlement, this Spectacle Island, I will then turn my attention to all these other settlements and get them to be 100% happy and so on and so forth. Some channels have gifts. Yeah, some channels worry about getting people to subscribe. I do not worry about people to getting people to subscribe. If you've subscribed, terrific. That's a compliment, you know, and I appreciate that. That means you want to see something more for some odd reason. But if you don't, you know, it's not a big deal. USS Nimitz. No, that's an aircraft carrier. That's not a sub. Bam! Naval humor. It's funny that there's some people that are still doing Fallout 4 videos, which I don't know why I'm doing them, quite frankly. Oh, yeah, that's right, because I wanted to finally have a perfect game. But it's always funny when I see these people that are supposedly experts, and they're spouting out knowledge that is oftentimes wrong. It makes me keep thinking that they've never played the game, really, or have sat and watched their settlers. I watch my settlers because I'm curious. I mean, look at the gorillas walking around. That's awesome. Damn it! I have it facing the wrong way. This is also why you test everything that you put down, you build. If you can sit in the chair, that means they can sit in the chair. Generally. This is why strong is the worst strong and dog meat are not good companions. Because you can't have them check out to if the chair you can sit in the chair or not. Okay, that's just awesome to me. So this is a mod that gives us, it's for the Contraptions DLC, gives you a couple different colors of warehouse accessories. I've gone through a lot of glass to do this and the other settlements. I like glass. It was meant to be a lighthouse, but I can't build any higher than that. I couldn't build that thing higher than that, so kind of got screwed. Well, I could have built it a little higher, but fuck it. And I can't get rid of this shit here in the center, so it's not a focal point, it's just gonna like gonna be there. Something's fucked up with the Contraptions DLC animation. Because I think this one has a gorilla in it. Here we go. Alright, I'm just... Cool. I don't know if anybody's watching or not, but... Unless anybody has any questions... I'm like spent on building and designing. Tonight, at least. Half of me wonders if that those gorilla cages at the other pack home got filled yet. Help defend Murkwater Construction!
Stumbling down.
Wow, wow, wow. Wow, 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 wow.
Can you say rah, rah, rah? Can you go woo? That's a yawn. They're puppies. They can defend themselves. All my settlements can defend themselves. One gorilla? Yeah. The Brotherhood will attack Raider settlements. And my settlers will always kick ass. Like a ragdoll. Awesome.
What's his name now? Good, 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 but I'm a jackal. What's his name now? Good, 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 but I'm a jackal. my window today. Could have tripped out easy, but I've changed my ways. It'll take time, I know it, but in a while you're gonna be mine, I know it. But do it in style.
Hey, wait there.
Solid vow, and you'll pay the bills. pretend that we are friends tonight. And in the morning we wake up and we'll be alright. Cause baby, we don't have to fight. And I don't want it to let it feel like a battlefield. A battlefield, a battlefield. Why does life always feel like a battlefield? A battlefield, a battlefield. Yes, you better go and get your armor. Never meant to start a war. No, I never want to hurt you. Don't even know what we're fighting for. Why does love always feel like a battlefield? A battlefield, a battlefield. Why does love always feel like a battlefield? A battlefield, a battlefield. Guess you better go and get your heart.
You were a super mutant. You were. Proper tense, buddy. Proper tense.
Thank you.
rock.
Brother dead, I slapped my girl, she got feds. I did that time and spent that bread. I'm headed home, I'm almost dead. I'm on my way, headed up the stairs. To my surprise, somebody replacing me. I had to take him to that ghetto university. Lights, cop lights, flashlights, spotlights, strobe lights, street lights. Fast life, thug life, drug life, rock fight every night. Brother, grandmother, hate me in that order. Public visitation, we met at borders. Told her she'd take me back, I've been more supportive. I made mistakes, I burnt my head. Court sucked me dry, I spent that bread. She needs her dad, baby please. Can't let her grow up in that ghetto university. Lights, cop lights, flashlights, spotlights, lights, street lights. Life, thug life, drug life, rock life, every night. Turn up the lights in here, baby. Extra bright, I want y'all to see this. Turn up the lights in here, baby. Know what I need, want you to see everything. Want you to see all of the lights. We going all the way this time. We going all the way this time.
Got you.
Tomorrow, there is a place.
You hear something?
Well, I can feel the city crawling around me. Can't seem to find my way. I can see a bright light calling through the dark night. Looking to find my way.
Got to run away.